Welcome to True View, where we bring the small group experience to homes and hearts. I'm Julie Van Gorp, and this is my co-host, Jamie Shaver. And we are welcoming you today, and joining us are Kate and Gina and Angela. And we're thrilled that you're joining us with a topic that you may or may not even realize how important it is, but it's on environmentalism. And we want to get God's view versus man's view.
And I think there's a big difference there. And I want to jump in with that because recently I'd really felt called and I sensed God telling me to do a specific Bible study over the summer. And as I started it, and I really found there were a lot of things that I believe went directly against what the Word of God actually says. And it was devastating for me to see, oh my goodness, like this is a very skewed view of some misapplied and misused scripture. And I just began praying both for discernment for me as in our group as we read through it. And we actually began to use it more as a tool to test our own discernment and to research what God's word actually said, because we just found that many of the falsehoods that were in it were something that needed to be researched. And we really genuinely wanted to know, what does God say on these issues? So to give you an example of just one sort of illustration of this, and this is a quote: "With the same care, he, being God, designed 60,000 miles of blood vessels in the human body. He also crafted hydrangeas, freshwater rapids, and hummingbirds." And you know, at first glance, ladies, it just kind of sounds like, oh, isn't that beautiful? But that is not what God's word says. And there are tremendous long-term consequences that come when we begin to say that that we are equal with God's creation as humans. So I want to hear what you ladies think about that. And what are some of the things that you see as problematic?
Well, we are not, God set us apart. You know, he actually breathed life into us in the Garden of Eden. I mean, he made it very clear in Genesis that we were set apart. We are to rule over the animals, you know, mm-hmm. not be ruled by them and not be controlled by them.
Absolutely. Yeah. And when we look and say, okay, so when we are going to say that God gave us dominion, what ends up happening when we begin to think that hydrangeas or a spotted owl, you know, recently I heard they had shut down an entire highway project in Texas because of a spider. And you know, God has said that he's given us dominion. And yet when we start to look at, when we get to where we're putting animals and spiders and insects and all of this about and calling it environmentalism or calling it creation care and not recognizing that those views, and when we begin to push that, especially in a political arena, what begins to happen is now laws are created that completely go against what God originally intended, which is that we would have dominion. And now we see, as we look around, that those very laws are being used so that those insects are ruling us and what we're allowed to do. And I'm sorry, that just makes me mad.
Well, and I think, Jamie, when we look at that and we begin to say, again, what are the implications when we really forsake God and what he says that we as Christians believe was the authoritative word of God of how earth was created in the Garden of Eden, and as you said, that he breathed life into humans and we are uniquely and specially made. But there was, just this past August, there had been an article that came out in the Huffington Post that was talking about how a number of people were surveyed to say if there was a choice between saving their pet dog or a stranger who happened to be a tourist, who would you save?
Oh, no. And from an oncoming bus, right?
Or like a train or something. You could only save one of them. And over 40% of the people said they would save their pet dog, over a human. And when you even look at some of their rationalizations, and as I started looking into that even more, some of them, Jamie, were as crazy of saying, but my dog needs me. You know, and this person, I don't even, they may not need me.
If you wouldn't save the dog, you shouldn't even be a dog owner.
Yes, it was even to that point. In fact, it was, you're not human if you wouldn't save your dog because your dog is depending on you. And we're going, how far have we come when we are equating an animal? And I love animals. You know, ask anybody who knows me. I've got a dog and two cats, mm-hmm. and you know, I've had one all of my life. But we look and say, to in any way say that an animal has the same value as that which was created in the image of God, which is only mankind, we start having those policies.
Yeah, and believe me, I'm the first to say, I don't want your corporate toxic waste in my waterways. Okay, so I do think that this is what is exciting about this topic, is there is a need, and I do believe that we are to take care of all that God has created and be good stewards. But that's really where I kind of want to get in and talk about that. What are your thoughts? Like, what is the difference in your own mind between being a good steward of something and then this more radical approach that we were witnessing in this Christian Bible study?
Well, I did the Bible study with you, and I had a lot of trouble. And I know I spoke to you about it several times, and I'm an avid recycler. Like, I really like to recycle everything. I make my own compost at home. We don't waste anything. I like to always repurpose, reuse. But the Bible study that we're talking about was really just off the mark, and it was so far beyond just saying, be responsible and take care of the earth and clean up. We all believe that God made this earth beautiful. He created everything that's in it. So yes, don't disrespect it. But it's different when you take an agenda and you're trying to sell it and spin it in a different way.
Mm-hmm.
So I was very turned off by the study in particular, because we felt as if, and I'm not just speaking for myself, I'm saying we, because I think the whole group did kind of realize that it was kind of missing the mark from actually maybe recycling or going out. Like, there were different subjects that were just, we just couldn't pinpoint them. We couldn't put our finger on it and understand exactly where she was going. And I don't know if it was necessarily biblical.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think that becomes such that issue is when you hear things that are out there, and we would ask you, test us, you know, just what Jamie was saying, where the Bereans were, you know, commended because mm-hmm. they would search the scriptures and test it. And I think, again, in the Bible study that you all did, you were looking to say, does this line up
we
with
had
scripture?
To be Bereans. Our spirit was in us saying, something's wrong here, something's wrong here. And like Gina would say, I sense there was something off, but we're not quite sure what it was. So we would just come together as a group and say, yes, what does scripture say about this? And then what place do we have to be good stewards? What does good stewardship look like when we're thinking about the environment?
Well, just to go back on that very briefly, the thing that's really hard is with me being a newer Christian, I was reading all this thinking I was doing something wrong because I don't have much knowledge. So it was hard for me to read a lot of these things, and I'm sitting here confused and you were setting me straight saying, no, it doesn't say that. And I kept saying, but I don't understand. This is implying this and that. So I definitely struggled with that, and I don't want to continue to bring up the Bible study that we were doing or whatever, but I know this really touches on that subject. But
I think being a good steward is one thing, but then trying to control the planet and creation, we're trying to be God. Yeah. Like, we're trying, that spider you were talking about, are you kidding me?
Yeah.
You know, I was just recently bit by a spider, crush it. No, I'm just kidding.
I'm with you on that.
I'm just kidding. No, but I'm saying, we're saying that God is not capable of taking care of the spider. I mean, we're not God. We have to be good stewards of what he gave us. He calls us to be good stewards. But, again, we can't put our place in God of ruling the
planet. Well, that control issue, Kate, that you mentioned, I think that's the critical one.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to look and say, what bottom line is at the root of an agenda?
Yeah. Right.
And is it about controlling? And what are the, you know, presuppositions that people who are behind that are making about who God is?
Well, oftentimes I think the people who are proponents of this type of theology, really, are thinking that they're doing good and not recognizing the insidiousness and the evil that is there when you begin to say that as humans, we are using up 30% more of this than the earth can sustain. Mm-hmm. When all of a sudden you begin to put limits mm-hmm. on things, mm-hmm. then all of a sudden you have to decide who's going to get them.
Yeah.
It creates a monster that kind of comes mm-hmm. from that place.
It creates fear. I'm sorry.
No, you're fine.
Go for it, girl.
No, but if scripture tells us he is the sustainer of all things, mm-hmm. then who are we?
Right.
You know, and we are stewards, but we're not the sustainers. And I think that it crosses a line where you begin to worship the creation and not the creator.
Right.
And I how think would you know if you cross that line?
That's a great question. But I mean, if you even think about it, I mean, God will sustain us with anything that we need. the deer naturally start changing the color of their coat in the winter to camouflage into everything.
Or look at the Israelites. They had absolutely nothing in the desert, and God sustained them.
That's right.
They were eating the bread of angels. Yep. And so to start to believe that there is lack and that somehow our human way is going to make an impact as to whether or not the earth is able to sustain itself for one extra minute is blasphemy. Like that is goes directly against what God's word says, and recognizing where our place is in the whole of God's creation. Yes, we are his prized creation. Yes, he got his hands dirty. Like he formed us from the dust of the earth. He breathed life and a soul into us. That right there sets us apart, but it certainly doesn't give us the right to assume or try to impact people and make it seem as though that if you're not driving a smart car, you're going to be the one to blame for the earth's ultimate devastation. That is not the case. And we also saw in this study, and the reason we keep citing the study is not necessarily the study, it's that this is a very prevalent viewpoint that we're seeing and you're seeing, I'm sure, if it's not in Bible study, you're getting these messages from magazines and advertisements because these messages are in our world. And it is a secular view, but then when you bring it and you try to take that secular viewpoint and then go fishing into God's word for some kind of scripture to back it up, what you end up with is twisted truth, okay? It's got a little bit of truth in it, but it's twisted. And that twist can really screw things up. You know, and you look at that.
I mean, and you look at Eve. You look and say, exactly. Satan didn't give a bold-faced lie. He twisted the truth just enough, and that's how he still operates today. To be that, to bring that deception, is just let's twist that a little bit. And, you know, Jamie, I know one of the things that you'd even talked about was kind of a twisting had to do with the impact of how we are treating the land and how that could impact the fact that we're not taking care of the poor, or what there was something like that that I remember you sharing with me.
Yes, there was this like direct correlation that somehow if you don't take care of the earth, it's a direct indication that you're also not taking care of the poor. And that's just not biblical. Well, but also to say that because of our lack of, let's say you're not a recycler. I mean, I recycle most things, but say that you don't at all. Does that now mean that that is why the land is going to be punished, is for your inability to recycle a soda bottle? I don't know. I mean, God's word has a lot to say about the land, and the land becomes a problem, and it's not because we're not recycling our water bottles.
When I think they're putting so much emphasis on these laws of protecting the spotted owl, protecting this, and you see children starving all around the country, like the focus is all wrong. That's when you cross the line. When you become so consumed with protecting the earth that you're forgetting all the people and all the other great needs, then that's definitely going a little too far besides recycling. I mean,
and it is. It's elevating the animal, the creation, worshiping over both the creator. And to look, what was the purpose that God even created creation?
Right.
The heavens and the earth declare the glory of the Lord. It's all about declaring the glory of God. And it's not about that the creation is to be put over the creator, is it? You know, and you might look at some other examples of that as well that are out there.
I think that like most everything, it's a heart issue. I think that where are our hearts? Because, you know, when you're seeking to be in God's will, and you will love his creation, and you will be a good steward out of the overflow of your heart.
Amen.
Out of the love of him. And it's not, you know, I think that this is just one more example of man trying to elevate himself to being God, or, you know, being in control of that which he is really not in control of.
And to sustain things, or to think that we can actually, in our humanness, understand the sustainability of anything. I mean, you look and say, there were so many articles back in the 40s and 50s that said we were going to run out of oil because of this. But lo and behold, 20 years later, before we ever ran out of oil, new technology had been developed that allowed us to go deeper. And then what did we discover? There were enormous sources of oil there that would would sustain for a much longer period of time. And then they say, well, this is a limited resource and we only have so much. Oh, but then new research comes out and shows that they refuel and they replenish. Mm. God is doing that. God is sustaining.
But I would go out on a limb here just to say that where are our hearts and our consumption? Because I do think that we have a responsibility for the pollution to a degree. Mm-hmm. You know, as far as stewardship goes, mm-hmm. I think that we can't deny our responsibility for what we don't do. You know, yeah. And so but I think again that goes back to the heart issue is, you know, what are we trying to fill our heart with all the consumerism that we're needing all these products and we're mm-hmm. needing all this mm-hmm. oil for the plastic,
or
for
we need all the convenience.
You know what I mean? And so
know?
I think if you were to go back and look, this is the fruit of it, but what's the root of it? Mm-hmm. Do you know
That's
what I mean?
That's an excellent mm-hmm. point, Angela. So, yes. Yep. I think so. Well, and I think when you mention that in the root, and I remember when Jamie would call me up and kind of be very, you know, animated and go, "You're not going to believe what was in this Bible study." And,
you know, just this frustrated.
And that. And, you know, for me, the big issue, and I think it goes back, Angela, to when you're saying, what's at the heart of it? Mm-hmm. When you read what God's word says about what really pollutes the mm-hmm. land, that was my mm-hmm. concern more mm-hmm. than what was mentioned in this study mm-hmm. about what did. It was what was lacking mm-hmm. of saying, these are the true things that
mentioned?
God's word. And I would just encourage, read, first of all, the whole chapter of Leviticus 18 mm-hmm. is on the holiness of God. And it talks over and over, these are the things that defile. And those are, quite honestly, one of them is a man sleeping with a man, a woman sleeping with a woman. You know, there are things of that nature. And we have just legalized that. And instead of calling it sin, we're celebrating it. And yet that's the exact thing that God says pollutes our land. Another, you know, what are some other things that you might think of that God's word says are actually polluting our land? Mm-hmm. Can you think of any other ones?
The killing of innocent life.
Yeah, I was going to say.
I mean, the shedding of blood. So often I know people will go, I cannot believe they sacrificed their babies. You know, when you'll read in scripture right. that they would sacrifice their babies mm-hmm. on the altars mm-hmm. of their other gods. Mm-hmm. And yet we in America have abortion is rampant, and that is a sacrifice of our children to our gods.
Yep.
And the gods of convenience, the gods of, you know, all of the other things that come with that, with those mind thoughts, and recognizing that also is defiling our land and just everything else.
The crumbling of marriage as marriage isn't, you know, families falling apart. That's mm-hmm. you know, that affects, that's sin.
And related to that, Kate, is the whole sexual immorality and sexual perversions. You know, I mentioned homosexuality, but we have fornication, we have adultery, we have the cohabitating, all of those things which are clearly against God's laws. And again, we want to make it clear, God can forgive that. But
for sure,
he says. But the reality is, we're living in a nation that is calling that which God has said is evil, embracing it. And then we're wondering what's really polluting this land, or the Bible uses the word polluting in some versions, some it's defiling, but it's those things that really, and the number one, you know, if we look at what's the number one commandment?
Mm-hmm. Love the Lord.
Love the Lord your God.
With all your heart.
And idolatry. That was really the sin. Yeah. When we look and say, you know, when the Israelites came into the land of Canaan, God's very clear, and I encourage you to get in the Word and read it. These are the reasons he says that I am spewing those people out of the land. I'm moving them because of those sins. And the primary were idolatry, sexual perversions, and the bloodshed of innocent. And we look at our nation today and go,
it's rampant.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So why is the land polluted? Like, I sit and go, if we really want to be like true environmentalists, I think we need to teach people to be repenting, turning from their sin, and loving Jesus, because that is truly going to be what heals the land. Mm-hmm. That's what brings restoration to the land. And I did think it was very interesting to see that literally the land was impacted by the sin of the people that were in that land. And it wasn't as much about the type of environmentalism that we see being promoted and talked about, because to me, until I really got in his word on this issue, I didn't even realize that that's really what we need to be doing, is to be healing and encouraging people to turn from their sin.
Well, I think it goes back to the scripture, you know, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all these other things will be added. Mm-hmm, and it is a heart issue. It is getting back, restoring the hearts of the people to God. And when you're living in, you know, whatever the sin is, name it, you know, everybody has their baggage. But when you make a conscious decision to make a law that says it's okay and continue to live in it and deny that there's anything wrong with it, and you continue down that path, where are you going to end up? You know, it's going to require a heart change, a turning back, a revival. I think that, you know, when your hearts are right with God and your relationship is restored with God, that stewardship comes, mm-hmm. you know?
So. Well, it seems like we have almost two opposing messages that are going on.
Oh, yeah.
You know, one which is you are in control. You have to take these specific actions. And if you don't, there's somehow guilt associated mm-hmm. if you're not recycling or if you're driving an SUV.
You could be the reason mm-hmm. that the whole earth, it goes through global warming.
Right.
Because you chose to not do your part. But then I think there's that line there of crossing over to becoming an advocate for thinking that humans can make that kind of a change.
Well, it's too much focus on things that God doesn't want us to focus on. Mm-hmm. You know, God, there's so much more to focus on, you know, leading people to Christ, you know, versus saving the owl. Like where, you know, I keep going to the owl, but that's one that sticks in my head. But
Right. Where
are you focused on? You know, are you going to try to sustain the earth that God's doing, or are you going to focus on reaching people for Christ?
And how does trust relate, you know, mm-hmm. just play into that whole mm-hmm. thing? Mm-hmm.
Well, and I think yeah. the thing, too, that's difficult is they start infiltrating with the children when they're young. Mm-hmm. So if my kids are watching television, mm-hmm. all these commercials are coming up and all these, you know, you should do this. And at my kid's school last year, it was, oh, turn the lights off for, you know, 30 minutes during the day. Let's see the impact it makes.
Well, and what's so interesting is you say that, Gina, even because, again, I'm the person that was alive before we ever had an Earth Day. You know, when I was growing up, we didn't even have, it was like Earth Day. What in the heck is
Every day is Earth Day when you love the Lord.
We're celebrating that we live on the earth and it all gives them glory. But I look and say, again, we're living in a world where before, for example, people had Good Friday off when I was growing up. That was just standard. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't have thought of going to school on Good Friday. Now it's all the schools are about, we've got to celebrate. And it really is a pagan mm-hmm. viewpoint of worshiping the mm-hmm. earth, which is, again, going back, Jamie, when you said the sacrificing your babies to the god of Molech, it is very much a pagan false god. And it's infiltrated, and even within the churches. Mm-hmm. Again, just like a lot of other false teaching that is infiltrated to the point where we're not getting at what the root, you know, issue may be.
But does it also mean that Christians shouldn't be buying smart cars or being mindful?
I think you have to be mindful. You know,
Absolutely.
I think that's going to come out of your love of the Creator. You know, mm-hmm. respecting the creation mm-hmm. is the natural overflow of that. I think, you know, we do have a responsibility to be good stewards. We do have a responsibility to, to be set apart, mm-hmm. you know, to set an example. But I'm trying to remember something you said, Kate, that I wanted to piggyback on. It might come back to me, but I think it comes back to the whole culture. Everything you look at, you read, you pick up, you see, billboards, it's all about you. Mm-hmm. You deserve it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And when it's all about us, we are going to mess it up.
Like that's
just,
right.
you know, that is just, that's just the bottom line. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so when we get our focus off of us, and I do feel at the guilt thing that you mentioned, or maybe it was to Julie, I just think that, you know, maybe that's a component of it is, you know, okay, we're using all this stuff. Now we got to mop it up and just try to manage, mm-hmm. you know, right. damage control, if you will.
And I think, again, we've got to look at what are some of the underlying agendas that can be there.
Sure.
And, you know, one of the things when we were talking about it is there are whole decisions, let's say, not to cut down these trees because of the spotted owl. You've mentioned
right.
that several times.
Yeah.
But there's even where, for example, and this sounds so ludicrous, but I know it's true, where there are even proposals, for example, that animals could have rights in court. And that they could even sue.
I want to hear that testimony. I do want to hear that testimony.
I know. That's kind of like where we go. And again,
you'd have to have an interpreter, a yeah. dog interpreter.
Yeah. And that could get really hairy.
Get it? Oh, no, boo.
But ultimately, when we look at it again, it's a matter of us thinking that we know better than God. And what is the root of the agenda, I think, in so many cases, though, is a presumption that we're going to overpopulate this earth and we can't sustain it. Mm-hmm. And we look and say, and you know, as a man thinketh in his heart, so he is. So we can look and go, what's the big deal if you're a radical environmentalist? Because it can end up leading to policies. And for example, we look in China.
Yes.
And the whole mm-hmm. element of infanticide is an outgrowth of them saying, we've yeah. got a population problem that we must control.
Limited resources.
Yes.
And now the problems they have because of those laws are far greater than they ever would have been mm-hmm. had they not limited that.
It mm-hmm. comes to not trusting God. It all comes yeah. to we're not trusting God.
But I think that comes with ignorance because there's yeah. so many people that just don't know the word.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
They mm-hmm. just don't know the word. And I have to say again, I said it earlier, I'm going to say it again, I am a newer Christian. Who I am today and who I was 2 years ago or 4 years ago is just a completely and totally different person. And every day I'm saying, oh my gosh, I didn't know that. Oh my gosh, I didn't know that. Oh my goodness, are you kidding? Mm-hmm. When you become, you know, when you start learning about something and you know the truth, when you find the truth, that mm-hmm. is when you find your answers. And unfortunately, it's people are shying away from church, and I don't know why. So maybe
well,
that's
I believe it's
a big
because at a lot of churches,
problem.
Truth isn't being spoken. Mm-hmm. And if truth isn't being spoken and being represented in a way mm-hmm. that honors Christ and that is his word going forward, there won't be that mm-hmm. fruit. And we also know that Jesus also says that he is going to offend many. Mm-hmm. Many are offended by his message. Mm-hmm. And the greater that the message grows and the larger that message grows from a secular culture in our country, I believe we're going to see more and more mm-hmm. of that falling away if people mm-hmm. aren't really understanding what it means to have a personal relationship mm-hmm. with Jesus, where he can speak into your heart, where he can give you that warning when you read something that goes, I'm not sure why yet, but this seems mm-hmm. off. Mm-hmm. But then to continue to know to go in his word where you're going to find that truth.
Mm-hmm. And when we look at that again, I think we could say, all right, how many of you are hearing in the public square out there or even within your church the real pollution that has come in and infiltrated our nation is due to the sin. It yes. is due to idolatry and the sexual mm-hmm. perversions and the bloodshed of the innocent. And even when I say that, that's not just abortion. Of course, we've killed 50 million plus babies. But the homicides that are going yes. on constantly, the injustice in the streets. We have unjust judges, and we have a lot of things that are going on in decisions. That's the thing that's really defiling our land. And the, you know, the grave implication to me is we're not hearing that many places. And that's the word that we need to be like you are, Gina. You've become educated. It becomes important for us to be a voice, even if we are offending other people.
Absolutely. And recognizing that we want to care for God and his creation. It does bring him glory. And therefore, we should be good stewards of all things that God gave us. And so I would encourage people, yes, take care of it. But recognize also, before you jump in and get on a bandwagon or something that has a greater agenda outside of just honoring the Lord God because of your love for him that you have in your heart. Again, we thank you so much for joining us here on True View, where we challenge and equip women to live authentic Christian lives. Connect with us on our website or also on Facebook. I'm Jamie Shaver. This is Julie Van Gorp, and we are committed to truth.